Hello, I'm Philip Stoten for EMS Now. I'm here at APEX 2013 in California, and I'm joined by Brian Smith from DEC and Mark Campbell from ASM. Guys, thanks for stopping by. What I wanted to have a chat about this morning is electronics in the automotive industry. I think we're kind of at a transition point where we've been adding more and more electronics into the car, and that's been an opportunity in itself. But we're now seeing maybe a transition where electronics is going to become quite fundamental to the actual product itself. So I think there's some changes there. If we can start just by exploring what your companies are doing in there and what individual challenges you get from the automotive sector. Brian, perhaps we can start with you.
Sure, yeah, there's a few things that we see. I mean, from a printing standpoint, believe it or not, the automotive boards are actually, there's so many of them, and they're actually getting smaller. Real estate's becoming more critical. Miniaturization is actually taking place in automotive electronics that you wouldn't necessarily think. You see these things in mobile applications and laptops, and some of those same challenges are now finding their way in automotive. From our standpoint, typically circuit boards have a keep-out region on the edges of the boards, and there's so little real estate, they're actually pushing up to the very edge more than normal. So we see that as a challenge. And certainly also in the automotive business, people they like to foolproof and do whatever they can to guarantee quality, especially in an environment like in the U.S. where any reworks going to be touched up by typically a pretty expensive laborer.
Yeah.
They're willing to do anything they can to guarantee first time right, improve first pass yields, and they're trying to put in tools at the front end of the process to improve those things.
And in terms of pure demand, in terms of pure market size, are you seeing some growth there?
Well, certainly. The automotive market has been very positive in the last couple of years, at least.
Yeah.
We've seen, particularly in the Americas, it's really become one of the more dominant parts of the market for us.
Yeah. Okay, and from your point of view, Mark, on the placement side?
Oh, definitely. I mean, we have quite a number of data sets that show us that the content of electronics inside the cars is almost 50-50 now. So metal to electronics is almost even now. So there's definitely a lot more technology, mixed technology that we're seeing that puts a lot of demand on the placement machines, because you got to be able to handle a broad spectrum of components. So, you know, with our multi-star head, we can handle a lot of those components.
Right.
And it's really allowed us to get into that the automotive market and have a very large market share in automotive, not just in the U.S., but we see a lot of that manufacturing in Mexico also, where the dollar cost for labor portion is much more consistent.
Okay. So, well, I'd like to explore Central and South America, but before we do that, what I'm curious about is kind of how that automotive supply chain works. Because most of the time you're not supplying direct to the car manufacturers, you're working with this group of automotive OEMs, which seem very, very specialized. Are there also EMS guys in those spaces?
Yeah, a lot of the companies that we deal with that you'd call traditional automotive companies are spun right out of the big three. You know, you have Visteon, and you've got what used to be Chrysler, and now has found its way into becoming part of Continental. And you've got Delphi, certainly is one of the major ones, but now there's companies like JCI, there's companies like Lear that were always considered kind of part of that second tier.
Right.
We hardly ever work directly with General Motors, Ford, and Chrysler, and the European car manufacturers at this point. But there are also traditional EMS companies, Jabil, Flextronics, that have very significant automotive strategies. In fact, Flextronics has fairly proudly announced that they're the number three automotive EMS in the world. And believe it, you don't think of them that way, because you think Delphi, you think Continental, you think all these other companies that are automotive centric.
Yeah.
And really, Flextronics has a very significant piece of their business, and Jabil as well, and a few others that are really, you know, dedicated to the automotive side of the market.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you've got to connect up the supply chain, because you've got you guys, you've got the EMS guys, the OEMs, which you're supplying as well, and then the car manufacturers. And I know you guys, particularly in Europe, have been actively working with some of the car manufacturers to kind of educate them on the electronic manufacturing.
Definitely
process.
The design for manufacturing is very key, because a lot of times what happens is you have two separate entities. You have the individuals designing the boards, and then you have the individuals that have to produce the boards. So we generally try to work with both sides, educate, you know, the design for manufacturing, but also work with the manufacturing side to really offer them a lot of tools to make their job easier and handle what they get, whether it's designed for manufacturing or they may have to do some on-the-fly adjustments when it hits the floor.
Yeah, and that might be designed for placement or designed for print, which is kind of an element of that. Do they look after that well? Because as you say, they're kind of encroaching on your handling space a little bit sometimes.
I mean, every company has a little bit different way of doing that. I think for the most part, automotive companies are very careful about design, and they tend to have good centralized groups that support the different sites in terms of design. So I think looking at the industry on the whole, automotive is probably better than most in terms of design for manufacturing.
And I guess part of that is the amount of time a product spends in the market. It's not like a phone that's got like a 6 month obsolescence and then it's on to the next thing. Just rolling back to the regions, Brian, from your point of view, Central America, South America, what's happening with the automotive and more importantly, the automotive electronics sector down there?
Yeah, the automotive electronics is certainly growing quite a lot in South America. I mean, Brazil is substantial. Even Argentina has some new, I guess Delphi's down there, there's a few other companies down there. And what these countries have done is they've got some, what you call tax strategies to incentivize companies to build locally. And as the laws change, companies are sort of forced to build things locally. And Brazil and Argentina have kind of grown their electronics assembly industry around that principle, and now more and more things are built there, and that also applies to automotive at this point.
Yeah. What about Mexico?
Mexico, we see kind of the same thing. I mean, when you look at the labor cost between, let's say, a China and a Mexico, there's a lot of quality there now.
Yeah.
So we see a lot of, we hear this word, resourcing coming or reshoring.
Yeah.
And we're seeing a good number of products come back to the U.S. and to Mexico, not just from a cost standpoint, but from a quality standpoint.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
quality in automotive is very key.
Yeah.
Traceability is very key when you're building ABS systems and control modules. And lives are at stake. It's very important that you build good quality.
Yeah, and we've had the reshoring debate, and we've had a lot of debate on what the right word is.
Yeah.
Some people are saying that it should just be regionalization, because I think there's kind of a more rational approach to where stuff's made now. I guess that's more true in automotive than any, because actually having stuff made close to where the car's being finally assembled is important. And maybe that's leading part of what's going on in Brazil as car manufacturers move there too.
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, the supply chain is getting more localized to support the actual OEM. And I think that's a trend that's in automotive just as well as it is in other aspects of our industry.
Yeah. So with respect to South America, with respect to Central America, you guys are already in Central America, but you're building stronger and stronger footprints in South America too.
Definitely. Brazil has been a big infrastructure focus for ASM over the past 12 to 18 months. Just because it's such a large market, it's a build for Brazil mentality, like Brian had mentioned, and the government's done a lot of things to ensure that it's a build for Brazil from an importation and tax standpoint.
Yeah.
So you definitely have to be a player there in Brazil to be successful in this industry.
Yeah, there's that structure. And Argentina, you see, and say you have some support down there, people down there?
Yeah, we've actually got a support network there. I mean, there's no choice. You're at the bottom of the world, really, when you're the Argentinian, Argentine,
Tierra del Fuego.
It's really the bottom of the continent, bottom of the Americas. The only thing south of that is Antarctica. So there's a small little duty-free or whatever tax, free tax trade zone where automotive electronics are built, among other types of electronics.
Yeah.
And it's the same sort of story as Brazil, but on a smaller scale because the population there and the middle class, the size of the middle class that can afford these sorts of things is a little bit smaller there than it would be in Brazil, but it's the same approach.
Yeah, and doubtless it's going to develop. Well, it sounds like exciting times in the automotive sector and new challenges for you guys. Thanks for stopping by to chat. Thanks for your time, and enjoy the rest of the show.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.